Thank you, organizers, for inviting me here. This is my first time in Korea, and I like it very much. I'm going to talk about the joint work with Rajendra Gujral, Mianishi, and Peter Russell. So, I would like to give an idea of proof of the following theorem. So let S prime be a normal, be a homology plane. So that is, it's normal surface with this is that of acyclic. And assume that the quadratic dimension of the smooth locus is 2. Then S prime has only one singular point, and it is a cyclic quotient singularity. So locally, So locally, analytically,
you assume that this prime is a phi.
It will follow. It follows for that, but we can assume this.
No
interval. Yeah. But we can assume this. So locally. In analytic topology, S prime is isomorphic to C2 mod some cyclic group Z A.
That's only locally in the neighborhood.
Locally. There is a small Euclidean neighborhood, which is all this. And this neighborhood is of the form, say, a ball mod ZA. Well, this is. So. And as a corollary, we have the following theorem that.
But you're not making any statement about the Riemannian topology, homotopy theory, I think.
In Mike's question was that the fundamental group has disappeared, which was present in the Gujral's talk.
The fundamental group of what?
Pardon?
Of what? Fundamental group of what?
In Gurdjieff's talk, there was a statement about the fundamental group of S prime minus the
single. Yeah, but no, yeah.
Okay.
No, that's.
You're not
stated his question for you.
Global statements about S-Prime.
Sorry?
Global statements about what S-Prime looks like.
No, no, there is no such a statement, yeah. That's it. It is.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
So if say let V be a smooth homology plane, of general type. That is that kappa bar of V is A2. This is logarithmic chordal dimension. So then the automorphism group of V is a cyclic group and it was already explained in Gurja's talk then how to how you obtain this corollary from the theorem. It was mentioned that more or less it was said. So it was said that the following, that if G is an automorphism group, then G acts there is exactly one fixed point. It was said that and also that this G acts freely outside this point. And no, it is not hard to prove this. It is more or less Smith theory. And then if you take a quotient, then it satisfies this assumption over there.
Yes, but so your Cayley's theorem, it has at most one singular point, otherwise I don't understand. Because, sorry, maybe I don't understand what you say.
What?
A homology plane.
Yes.
It has a singular point. And now, downstairs, let the B be a smooth homology plane.
Yes.
At most one singular point in the best state.
Yeah.
It's
a strange
question. Yeah, I understand.
I mean, the main theorem, Prince is right, it just says, you assume it's a singular, as prime is
yeah.
Singular.
If it is smooth, then it is also true.
Well, doesn't exist.
So then, and then the analytic type of the singular point here is of it must be a cyclic singular point. So then by the theorem, so this G is a cyclic group. So our conjecture is that this A here, or the order of this group in this statement is bounded by 6.
Sorry, but anyhow, I don't explain why it's a cyclic group.
Well, local analytic type of the singular point here, we have the image of P under the quotient.
The local stabilizer is cyclic, but
because it acts
okay,
No, that's, that, I think it's because it acts freely. So the analytic type of this singular point here is given by this action of G, local action of G.
No, why P should be fixed by the whole group? That's the main point.
This I am not going to prove.
I mean, alternative to it, really, it could be that there is a fixed point for a subgroup.
Yeah, sure. So this is a theorem that that there is exactly one fixed point. One has to prove that, and that G acts freely on this complement. So, I'm not going to talk about this. It can be proved, and it is not very hard. So, because it is not my main theorem. So this is the statement that. So now, the idea of the proof of this theorem above, and we take the minimal resolution of the singular points here. So this is pi, call it S. So this is a minimal resolution of singularities. And let E be an image of this reduced divisor. And we embed this S, this is into some S bar, a projective in such a way that this complement, we call it D, is a simple normal crossing divisor. And we will assume that this D is minimal simple crossing divisor, what I call NC minimal. So it means that any minus one component in this is a branching component. This is our setup, and now there's a lemma. And it was already stated in this in Goja's talk that the following is true. First, there is only one singular point. Say it Q. One point. Second, that.
I don't understand what are you proving the main theorem?
Yes. So we start with this. B1 of D is zero, it means that D is a rational is a rational tree. Moreover, D is a connected rational tree. Composed of P1s. And we should write here that also we should mention that S is rational. And it is by Gurdjieff-Shastri theorem. That homology planes with quotient singularities are rational. Now, the main tools we...
I mean, the dilemma was an E8 singularity.
Yeah, but this it was, but it was a special kind of a special case of quotient singularity. So everything can be repeated in the same way to this setup. So from topology, we have. This is the fact that it is a rational tree.
So is it true also here that the singular point is of type V8?
Oh, no. No. It's a quotient singular point. It's not of the type E8. Any type.
Because there you have unimoduli.
Yeah, but not in this case.
Why not?
Yeah, because in his talk, he assumed that this smooth locus is simply connected, and it gives that D and E are unimodular.
I mean, I think the intersection form on a form, I mean, is always unimodular, contrary to
Yeah, but we are not able to show that this peak is generated by the components of D and E in this case, under this.
But why not? Because it's a homology statement if something generates. It's a Meyer-Vittori sequence, so the fundamental group should not have any importance.
No, but even the homology is not trivial yet.
Pardon?
Homology of the smooth locus is not trivial yet.
Yeah, I don't assume that.
The homology of the smooth locus
is not trivial.
But it's written there.
It is a homology. Where?
It's always prime.
It is global.
Thank you. Okay, thank you.
So what's so there? Your assumption is H of upper I is cohomology is zero, not homology is zero. Does it make any difference?
I see. Okay. Of the singular surface.
Okay. No.
Yeah,
it's
just the same, just equivalent.
What?
That? Everything previous.
Yes, okay, very good. Thank you.
But what we can prove that, maybe later.
So there's only one connected E and one connected D.
Yes.
There's one exceptional thing coming
yes.
out of the singularity.
Yeah. So this E, this resolution tree of the singular point is connected.
Yes.
Is connected. So from now on, I will assume that it is a non-cyclic singularity. So suppose we assume now from now on. There's only one singular point.
Are you proving that or are you assuming that?
It's only one singular point.
This is in lemma. Here.
So you are not proving the lemma now?
No. Okay. This is playing with long homology sequences. And we assume that this Q, the singular point here, is not cyclic singularity. That means that this E is a fork. The resolution tree of a cyclic singularity is a chain of P1s. Otherwise, it is a fork. by fault.
As for now, it wasn't said that the singular point has to be of quotient type.
In fact.
Okay. One point of quotient of I think that
why do you need it? Proceed. I don't know.
Because
this is my statement.
It is a cyclic quotient singularity, there is nothing to prove. So you may assume that it's not a cyclic quotient singularity.
Yes. And we come to
proceed.
Because it is no, otherwise it is some. No, we know that it follows from it. It can be proved that it is of quotient type. So it is quite simple singularity.
But you need this also in part C of the lemma, or not? S is rational.
In here it is in order to know that the singularity is rational singularity.
Just rational.
But in this case, so. It is rational, so you may apply this.
As you see, the argument which was not given by Kunjar was anyhow some inequality implying that.
No, this is. I will give the same argument.
By which not given argument you conclude that it's of course entirely.
Of course, I can prove this lemma.
No, but
it will take.
Sorry to interrupt you, but if you would just give key words, let's say,
okay.
We use this, just two words.
We use this Miyayoka, Bogomolov Miyayoka Yao inequality.
Uh-huh.
It implies this is.
The special form of these indices which occur, you conclude that it must be cyclic.
Yes. Okay. No. It's not cyclic. This is a quotient. And now our goal is to rule out the case when it is that the resolution is a fork. So we need to prove that the resolution tree is a chain. So A follows from the inequality. It is Bogomolov Miyayoka Tau. Miyayoka. Yao. Which was already mentioned. And the rest, B, it is from topology. So I will need this BMY inequality, so in the following form. Let me state this as follows, that but before more about Zariski decomposition. So let's take a smooth surface M and embed it in some projective surface M bar and such that T equal to this is simple normal crossing divisor with NC minimum. And then we have and assume that the quadratic dimension of M is non-negative. Then we have this Zariski decomposition of the divisor K where P and N are Q divisors. N is effective, P is nef, and P is orthogonal to N. And moreover, the intersection matrix of N is negative definite. So this is the Zariski decomposition. And now this inequality, which is mentioned over there. So in this notation, let T1 up to Tk will be all connected components of T, which contract to quotient singularities. Then the following satisfied. If kappa bar of M is 2, we have the following inequality. Where gamma I
is Kato.
This is, yes, this is where gamma I is the local fundamental group at Qi, where Qi is a singular point obtained by contraction of Ti. Yeah. If we assume only this, then when we assume 0, 1, then P squared is 0. This is, and then, but still we have this inequality. So in this version it is original BMY inequality, and this is, it was proved by Langer. So we use both. Now, what is the idea of how the method we use here? We examine this the boundary divisor D, and finally we come to conclusion that this D is quite simple. So we prove the proposition. This is the main part of this proof, that D is star shaped. That is, D looks, the dual graph of D is like this. there's one branching component and several chains sprouting out of this branching component.
Branches are just linear.
Yes, these are chains, linear chains. And call this the branching component B.
And the lengths are the same.
So, sorry?
And also the lengths are the same or no?
No. That's in general, no.
Okay.
That, and call this these branches, let's call Z1, Z2, Z, say, okay. And further, we reduce to even simpler form, then we have precisely three branches. So that's such a thing we call a comb. And in fact, this comb occurs to be a fork. So this is the essential part of the proof, to show that this D is a fork, a comb, and then a fork. So I'm not there's no way to explain details, of course, but only idea.
Case 3.
Yes. So when we have let us so finally it will appear that this is like, this is not a dual graph, but, and so D looks like this. A fork with one branching component B. So what we use here, what is our approach? So we consider, we take a branching component of a D. So idea of proof of the proposition. Only idea. So we take a branching component B of D. Let us remove this component. So then we can write D minus B is a sum where Qi are connected disjoint. It's not trees. So these are branches of this B in D. And then we consider the surface Y, which is bounded by our E. E is inside, this is the resolution of this singular point, original single point. So this is S bar minus, and I take the sum of these branches plus that E. So the picture is like this. Here we have some B branching component and some trees. And here we have this resolution fork. This is E, right? And now we add to the surface the 2S minus E. This is a complement of this this is equal to S prime minus this singular point, original singular point. We add this curve here, punctured curve. So now the bounded divisor of this y consists of this qi's and e. It is disconnected. But the Euler characteristic of y is equal to 2 minus the number of branches here. It is obvious. So it is negative. And once we have something which has a surface, open surface, which has negative Euler characteristic, then here we have this the negative term here. So it gives us some estimation for these denominators. This is the idea why we want to pass to, you want to have something with negative Euler characteristic, then we can do something. Of course, there is no guarantee that the Euler, that the Corrada dimension of y is non-negative. So we have to consider several cases here. So finally, when we consider these cases, we examine the surface y. It may be, many things may happen. It can be of negative Corrada dimension or non-negative. It can be minimal in the sense of minimal open surfaces, or maybe not. So we have to examine this carefully. And finally, we come to the conclusion of the following lemma, which describes more or less the branches, qi's. So the lemma is like this. Lemma. We have the following one of the following takes place. There are four cases. First, all components. All connected components QI contract to quotient singularities. We say that a thing which contracts to a quotient singularity, let us call it, to be contractible. B. R equal to 3. R is the number of these branches. The number of these branches. R. So R equal to 3. Q1, Q2, contractible. And I will say, contract to quotient singularities. Q3 does not. And moreover, this local fundamental group corresponding to this singular point we obtain by contraction are very trivial. So this is Z2. So this is A1 singularities. C, R equal to 3, Q1 is a chain, Q2, Q3 are not chains, and the intersection matrix of Q2 and Q3 are intersection matrices. Of Q2, Q3 are unimodular. Moreover, there exists a curve C, such which is, this is a minus one curve. I mean smooth P1, smooth projective, smooth rational minus one curve, C. such that C times C meets E and Q1 transversally and is disjoint from and also yeah. And such that E plus C plus Q1 contracts to a smooth point. So the picture is here. It is again a special situation, rather special. So we have this Q1s here, some three, Q1, Q2, Q3. Here we have E, and there is a curve C which looks like this is our fork. Like this, something like this, meets Q1 and E transversally. And also this device that contracts to a smooth point. So we first contract, this is a minus one curve. And then successfully we contract everything to a smooth point. So it will disappear. And the last case is again, R equal to 3. Maybe I will skip this, because maybe it's not very important what is precise statement here, right? So this is the last case, which is similar, the description is similar to this, the C. Similar, now I will, again, R equal to 3. And this is similar to C in nature. So again, there is a one sum minus one curve which meets two components nicely and contracts to a smooth point and something. I mean, it is not important. So anyway, by examining the surface Y and all possible cases here, then we come to such a conclusion. And now we play with that, because this our tree it can be applied to arbitrary branching component in D, right? This. So then we take one branching component, take these branches, and then take a branching component in one of these branches, and again apply this, and then after some time, we come to the conclusion that we must have this, that it's the only possible. I'm not able to describe this in more detailed way. Okay, so. Okay, and then we reduce also everything to, and after we get this, we can proceed a bit further and get that D is finally a fork. And now how to eliminate this case, this final case, the final proof of our so then we can assume that, now we assume that D is a fork. And now we have two arguments for that, two different proofs, which gave contradiction. I will describe only one. I think it is easier to describe than the second one. And also, this proof gives some hope for generalization of this the result for this conjecture. Namely, but then I have to introduce something concerning this negative Zariski decomposition. So assume that this is.
It has to do with the permutation of the.
No. Six has does with the fact that three over A is smaller than if A is bigger or equal to 7. And then, and this inequality plays, this is, this inequality is important in this consideration. It comes, the three comes from BMY. There's three over there. And this is important. So, okay, so now we take this Zariski decomposition of the divisor D plus E. So this is P plus this negative part. And the fact is that the surface, this maybe more precisely this, the pearl S bar and this D plus E, this is this boundary divisor, is minimal in the sense minimality in open surfaces. So more or less it means that it's not exactly, but essentially it means that there is no a curve, minus one curve, which meets both things transversally, or meets only one of them. It follows this fact. It follows from BMY again. When you pass to minimal model, if such a curve exists, then we have to contract this and pass to maybe some further more curves we have to contract. So we pass to minimal model, apply BMY, and then we get contradiction. No? So anyway, this is minimal, let's assume that. And then if the surface is minimal, then there is explicit description of this negative part here. N equals to the so-called bark of the divisor D plus E. Bark. This is, I will explain what bark means, what is it, but this is a bark. Say bark D.
Bark of a tree.
Yeah, because this is something get So computing this, that is a peeling. We peel off the bark of the divisor and we leave P. This is the essential part. Bark D is a sum of barks of these branches Z1, Z2, Z3. And bark of such a branch, it is a Q divisor supported on this Zi. Such that times any component Tj equals to zero if Tj is not a tip of Zi, and it is minus one if Tj is a tip. And this is for all component
tip, you mean the end.
Yeah. Contained in this, we call it tweak. This is a tweak of our tree, right? Such a branch, and this is a tip here. So if I take such a Tj, then it must intersect, then the bark is defined by this, conditions, uniquely. And it is a...
Sorry, you're also considering the end which meets B?
Yes, yes.
Both.
Yeah, yeah. So intersection of this end is zero with the bark, and this intersection of this end is minus one, and all others also zero. It is uniquely determined because this is the matrix, the intersection matrix of this such a tweak is negative definite. And then, this is uniquely determined, and this is an effective divisor with coefficients between 0 and 1. And in similar way, I define the bark of the fork. Let us skip this. It is a bit... For a tip, it again must intersect with intersection numbers minus 1. For any only the only difference is that for this intersection number is 1. Anyway, let us in the similar way we can define the bark of the fork, which is here, this fork E. And now this n, this negative part, is equal precisely to this. So we know that, if we know D and E. And also now, we compute, we take this Zariski decomposition. Also, let us now, it is very easy now to compute the, take, say, component CI, let be component of D plus E, one of these irreducible components of this one. Then we take this positive part here, this P here, and then P times CI is equal 0, except one case when CI equals to the branching component B, then P times B equals to 1 minus 1 over D1, where DI, it is the determinant of the intersection of the minus intersection matrix of
Z times n is 0.
Yeah.
If okay, and if also P times CI is 0,
yeah,
then K plus D plus
E times CI is 0.
Yeah, why is it should be 0?
No, it is. It is. It is.
Any component in D plus D, why does it have this property of being orthogonal?
Not any component. If I take
component CI.
Except, yeah, so that's true, except this this case.
But why?
So take such a CI, okay?
Yes.
Like this. And then we take this.
Orthogonal to N.
Yeah, so we compute CI times K plus D plus E. It is CI times P plus CI times N.
You want that the left-hand side is 0?
Yeah, it is. Because it is by this is equal to CI. Okay, no, but I mean, hurry. So this is equal to this plus, because it is rational smooth by junction formula, this is minus, no. Yeah? So this is minus 2 by injunction, and this is 2.
It's a 3, okay.
Yeah.
It's okay, it was obvious, but I mean, clear.
And the similar thing is when we take the tip, but for B we have this. Of course, we should know this this barks here, but everything can be computed in terms of the determinants. So, so this P is uniquely, because the components of D plus E generate peak up to Q. Numerically generate peak. So then P is uniquely determined by these conditions. And we can And it occurs then that P is supported on this D. And we can find explicit formula for this P in terms of self-intersections of these curves here. So there is an explicit formula for this P by this. P is supported on D. How much time you have? So then we can compute P squared. If you have the formula for phi, you can compute P squared. And the P is, it is equal. Where di is the determinant of this tweak, zi, that I. Now
there is a bracket missing.
Yes.
That's most important because of the square.
Yes. And now there is a fact which was another lemma which we proved, it follows topology, implies that the determinant is equal to minus determinant of E. This is minus, call it minus A, determinant of this, of the set intersection matrix of this E here.
Yeah, because it's the index of the dark sound.
So this is, we can replace this by E. No, okay. Now, if we take a square of both sides here, we have K plus D plus E. Okay, maybe I will skip this. Consider this once more. By BMY, which is over there, we have that this is equal, if you apply BMY in this the form which is stated over there, then we get that this is equal to less or equal to 3, and this is the order of gamma, where gamma is a local fundamental group at Q, our original singular point, which corresponds to this fork E. Now, gamma, abelianization of gamma is a local homology group at Q. And the order of this local homology group is equal to A, the determinant of this tree. So we have that mod gamma, that order of gamma is bigger or equal to at least 2A times A, since this is non-trivial. This gamma...
Why is gamma not abelian?
Gamma, because it is a non-cyclic, so this is not abelian for sure. The only abelian group which can appear here are cyclic groups.
I mean, but is this a three? This is a triangle group. It's a group generated by three elements with product one, or
no?
No.
So this is much more complicated. This is a detailed description of those gamma which can appear here. There are small groups in GL2C, right? And they are not abelian for sure, unless it is a cyclic. And so this local homology group is abelianization of that, because it is a local fundamental group. Yeah. So we have that this order A divides gamma, but it cannot be equal to gamma. So we have this. So when we apply this inequality here, and we put this into this inequality, we get the following. That is less or equal 3/2. When we replace this by A. Okay, so then this gives us this inequality. Now this is very elementary. We can bound DIs. It appears that D1 is less or equal to 3, D2 less or equal to 5, and D3 less or equal to 19. If we assume that this. So if we know this determinants, we know these branches. They are determined. Also, it can be proved, no problem at all, that B squared is equal to either -1 or -2. So we know D completely. And also because if you know D, we know determinant of D. So then we know A. If we know A, we know E. So now we have only finite many of cases to consider, very explicit cases. And now we verify, in each case, you can verify this formula, of this formula. So we have to take a square of this formula and look at whether the data satisfy this. Also, we can compute K squared. And then we can also verify k squared by the number of d plus e, that the number of components, it is by Netter formula, it is 10. So this is again another thing which has to be satisfied. And after, when we make the list of the cases, and then verify everything here, everything can be ruled out. And this is more or less, this one that is quite technical. And now, a few words about this conjecture. I think that I am almost convinced that we can repeat everything in the case when it is not a fork, which helps a lot, but if it is a chain, but not very small.
There is a
chain? Chain, but not very small chain. So this EA must be, if I suspect that if A is bigger than 6, then we can, again, by this method at least, we can rule out this. But there will be much more more cases, because then we have only, here we have this bound. And also, there will be a problem with this proposition, which describes this lemma over there, which describes four cases, that states we have only four cases, there will be more. But I hope that can be done. And I should mention also that there are the known examples of such surfaces S prime. This the singularities are indeed cyclic and of order 2 on 3. So no example which I know about is for 4 or 5. So this conjecture is So this is idea of the proof. Sorry if I was not so. Like, it's difficult to explain this. This is really a long thing. Many cases to consider. So.